Some people are born gay. No one can change their sexual orientation. Even trying to change is harmful. Gay activists and the entire sexual revolutionary establishment want you to believe that. Even one individual who changes their self-identification from gay to straight disproves this claim that no one can change. Ken Williams leads the Changed Movement, a small army of people who have successfully journeyed away from an LGBT identity. Don't miss my interview with Ken. Today, I'm going to interview a unicorn, an appealing but entirely imaginary creature, a person who's changed his sexual orientation from gay to straight. I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse for the Ruth Institute, and you and I have been told a million times that people are born gay, no one can change, and even trying to change is harmful. But you know, logically speaking, even one man who changes his self-identification without lasting psychological trauma, even one guy like that disproves this sweeping statement. So at this point now, the committed sexual revolutionary will respond in one of two ways. They'll say either this guy wasn't really gay to begin with, or they'll say he will surely backslide and revert to his true identity, which is, of course, gay. According to the sexual revolutionary narrative, my guest today doesn't really exist. Ken Williams is an author, lecturer, and pastor who journeyed out of homosexuality. He's co-founder of the Changed Movement, which protects biblical family values, responds to LGBTQ with understanding and action, and equips church and government leaders to do the same. Ken lives in California with his wife and their four incredible children. Ken Williams, the unicorn, welcome to the Dr. J Show.
It's good to be here. I appreciate it. My pastor has called me a unicorn before, so I'm comfortable here.
Is that so? So which is it? Were you really gay to begin with? Or how long have you been married to this woman and these kids? Where did these kids come from? I mean, what's up with you, Ken?
Well, I had done some gay things in my past and had all the desires and feelings and didn't have any kind of powerful or lasting attraction to females for a long time, and then found myself drawn and attracted to this girl that I had begun building a friendship with for a year, and we've been married for 17 years, and we worked together to create the four children. So I'm living a life I did not think was possible for a long time, but I'm loving it.
Tell us about your personal journey of encountering the fact that you had same-sex attraction and then how you journeyed away from that.
Yeah. Mine was a years or decades long journey, unlike some. I know people all along the spectrum that have journeyed out of an LGBTQ life. Mine, you know, there wasn't a lot of help back in my day. It was hard to find it, and people, it wasn't okay to talk about sex and all that. But you know, I was raised in church, and I was there several times a week, gave my life to Jesus at 8 years old. And I mean, I meant it. I wanted to please him. I wanted to know him, follow him. And also that same year, though, I was exposed to hardcore gay pornography. Just a group of boys that were playing in a field opened up a boot box, and there it is. And, you know, Dr. Morse, the things that I saw, obviously I won't describe, but it's not probably what most people would think. You know, when you hear about pornography, you think, oh, okay, I see some people that are naked. No, this was men behaving very badly, doing grotesque things and dishonoring another person, dehumanizing things. And I already had what I would say was like a masculinity wound, because I was the skinny, short boy in every class growing up. And so to keep up with the other boys, to fit in, to not be bullied or mocked, that was a major struggle. It was much easier from my childhood to go hang out with the girls. They were kinder. They were more accepting. You know, there wasn't a competition. It was just, hey, I believe I was called to be a pastor from birth. And so I like to talk deeply. I like to talk. I like to, you know, get in deep with people. And I had that even in childhood. So I wasn't wanting to see who could throw the football the farthest or tackle someone. I was wanting to have a meaningful conversation. So you can just see, looking back in my story, where I was not connecting with my same-sex peers deeply, or I was feeling rejected, disqualified, all these things. And I wasn't feeling like I was one of the card-carrying males. It was quite the opposite. And also, you know, unfortunately, after viewing that pornography with the other boys, those boys then catalyzed, they then started trying to act out some of what they'd seen on those pages. And I got swept into that just as a naive 8-year-old young boy. And
were these boys, hold on, Ken, were these boys older than you, or were you all roughly the same age or what?
We were roughly the same age.
Okay.
Roughly, you know, I mean, they might've been a year or two older than me, but
okay. Okay.
Just found my, you know, I mean, nobody, I think this is very common. Nobody ever sat me down and said, if anybody ever tries to do such and such, you know, I mean, I had no idea this even existed, and you find yourself there, but the guilt and, I mean, my conscience knew, I mean, I didn't want that. And so just felt so dirty. I'm like, I don't know what this is, but it's wrong. And I can't ever let another person know that I've done this, because I know Jesus, I feel convicted, and I don't know what to do to get this off of my conscience. It was just, so I just started kind of pretending at 8 years old.
That's really, really interesting for a number of reasons. If I could pause on this, because sure. This is so interesting to me, that you knew it was wrong. Like immediately you knew it was wrong. And the other boys, did you have a sense that the other boys also knew it was wrong and were bluffing their way through it or something? Or what did you think they thought? That's kind of a complicated question, but.
Yeah, I think they thought it was, I don't know, something kind of a thrill or something like that. I didn't observe them like having any kind of moral thoughts about it. It was just something that just kind of happened from time to time. But I would always walk away feeling very dirty, you know.
And so this was an ongoing thing. This wasn't like a one and done kind of situation.
It was, but there was a family move. And so I think it was a couple of few months, something like that. But, you know, I never, the guilt and shame just sat on me, you know, for years and years until I finally had confessed. That's on into the story.
But to pause on this point, I've talked to any number of people who were sexually abused as children. Mm-hmm. And one of the tropes that you hear from the sexual revolutionaries is that the only problem is the guilt and shame that adults impose on it. And the kids are really fine. The kids don't really care. I have yet to encounter anybody for whom it was really fine. You know, they all had an instinctive revulsion to what was going on. In your case, nobody even touched you exactly. You know, it's not like some of these kids were actually raped, you know, which physically hurts. You know, but just the viewing of it, you knew you were viewing something that wasn't right. Instinctively, you knew that.
Yes. Yeah. I mean, I would say, you know, according to scripture, the law of God is written on our hearts. And so it's built into me that this is okay, or this is not okay. It did not feel okay, you know, and it wasn't even something I wanted. I mean, like I can say, I didn't want to have been seeing things like that, but there was some kind of a thrill or something. It was something it was intimacy, right? Like when people are bearing parts of themselves that you don't ever see, there is an intimate opportunity there. It just might be for my good, or it might not be for my good. God, you know, I think God clearly set it up to where the fabric of society is family. Family is what society is built on. It's what every I wish it were the case that we could have every family where the children have a mom and a dad who are tending to them and it raised them up, and then everyone has kind of a basic needs met through the system of family, right. And intimacy happens in that context. well, this is so far outside that it's like I'm knowing things about another person that I don't need to be knowing. And that didn't feel right. good for me to know that, you know, just felt wrong.
Yeah. Yeah. So then what happened?
Yeah. You know, if I speed forward a few years, then it's like I'm a preteen or maybe I'm 13 years old or so. And I'm realizing, you know, the boys have for years have been talking about how girl crazy they are, you know, and it's like, and I would give I remember giving at least internally an eye roll, like, oh, brother. And I think it was 13 or 14 years old when I realized, oh, the reason that this is kind of irritating to me is because I'm not girl crazy. Actually, if I'm being honest, I'm noticing, you know, a couple of boys, and that seems like more of an exotic kind of a thrill to me to notice him than any of the girls. And then when I was 15 or 16 is when I had watched a movie, and the movie was about this boy about my age who discovers he has same sex attraction and doesn't want it. So he goes to his parents. His parents take him to the psychiatrist. The psychiatrist tries to help him and eventually says, you know what, this is just how you're made. And so we've got to just get, you know, the story then went on that really his community just needed to accept him for who he was. And I mean, I was just panic stricken, Dr. Morse. I'm like, there is not anything in my heart or in my mind, my consciousness, that is wanting to live a gay life. I'm just finding that is what I'm drawn to. And I don't have any understanding about any of it. It's just, I don't want this, but it's how I feel. And the consternation and the distress internally over having strong desires for something that I don't want was very troubling. In other words, is there the God component of my caring what God thinks? Yes, but I'm telling you, even separate from that, I did not want that. I did not want to be different from everybody else. I wanted to be one of the boys and belong, and I wanted to have a wife and a family and all those things, but that is not where I found myself.
And so what happened then? What did you do? At this point, had you told anyone about this at this point, Ken?
I had not. Like I'd been, whether you're talking about on the nightly news or just in culture or inside the church, I'd never heard any person say anything grace-filled about a homosexual. Not once. I'd heard plenty of things over the years that were derogatory or that indicated that these were bad people. But I had no reason to think that anyone would know what to do to help me or have any grace for me. So I was making sure that no one knew me. I worked mm-hmm. real hard at that all day long, I felt like. You know, especially going through middle school and high school, and you know, you're in close proximity to everybody and people are starting to date and all that. And I am trying real hard to make myself look normal, but not feeling that way at all. And then, you know, really my version of homosexuality, I'm going to say, was like the codependency. I'm not ready to say that every situation of homosexual feelings or anything like that is attached to kind of codependency or emotional dependency, but I think it's real common, and mine certainly was. And so I was mm-hmm. looking for, I had canceled masculinity long before the Barbie movie did. I had canceled. I thought it was wrong. I thought that masculinity was less than, because I saw the women around me were kinder. They were nicer. It seemed more like what Jesus would do or be. And the men were rough and tumble and all that. And I didn't think that that's how it was godly. So I canceled masculinity. And the problem is when you're male and you cancel masculinity, then who are you?
Right.
Like, because in fact, people have either male chromosomes or female chromosomes. So if I'm male and I've canceled maleness, then what is left? Like, how do I manifest myself to the world or know who I am? So in all of that confusion, what I was doing was whichever male seemed like the most noble version of masculinity, is what became exotic and attractive to me. And so what became exotic was masculinity, but the only kind I would allow would be a really kind, but also strong and kind of, you know, I was looking for a better version of me, for one thing. Like, since I don't know who this is, that's now looking attractive. And so what I would do is I would sidle up to whoever that boy was.
Yeah, that's what occurred to me as you were talking, that had to be intoxicating for you to finally get some affirmation. And of course, there's all the physicality of touch and the connection between the body and the mind and the soul and all of that. All of that goes into overdrive. It's addictive. It has an addictive quality to it.
Big time. I was so destitute in not knowing who I am and not feeling like my needs were getting met. Because keep in mind, the more I latched on, and this happened several times in my teens and the more you're fixated on the one person, the more you're not relating to all of the other people in your life. And so your life gets real small. And when that person is no longer there, you're real lonely. So I was profoundly lonely, profoundly disconnected from people and from understanding who I was. And so I eventually tried to latch on to another guy, and that guy would never give me enough attention. It gave me a trickle, but not enough. And that made me angry. And so that got real toxic. And so finally, out of not knowing what to do, I thought, I'll sneak into the Christian bookstore. Surely there is some kind of a resource in the Christian bookstore that offered some hope out of this. And I looked through the whole self-help section. There was nothing on homosexuality. There was a self-help book that had every kind of challenge, and it had maybe a half a page or a page, and it offered zero. It said, if these are your feelings, they will never change. But if you see a counselor weekly from now on, like for the rest of your life, then you can refrain from acting these out. But this is the thorn in the flesh that's been given to you for your good. This won't change. And it even said it'll probably cost about $250,000 over the span. And I was a busser at Mark's Feed Store barbecue restaurant making $3.35 an hour. So I didn't know how I was going to come up with that kind of money. You know, I mean, it's funny, right? But, you know, my first moments of being suicidal was walking out of the Christian bookstore.
Wow. Oh, Ken. Wow.
You know,
so this would have been early 90s. This would have been like
in 1989.
Wow. So what was the turning point for you? What broke this logjam?
That was the beginning of the turning point, because I just couldn't go any, I started thinking of ways to end my life that wouldn't look like was suicide and therefore completely destroy my family. And, I just couldn't keep going. And I realized, okay, I can't do that to my family. And so I just went in my basement one night. I wrote 9 pages of my pain. All the thoughts and fears and hopelessness and self-hatred and anger and profanity, it just all poured out onto these pages. I cut school the next day and handed those 9 pages to my youth pastor. God bless the youth pastors. And he just, you know, read it and was like, okay. He said, hey, you know, Ken, you're not gay. And which was, to me, the perfect thing to say. And also, though, I'm like, well, but what do I do with all of this? You know, like definitely doesn't feel true. Right. And so he said, well, we're going to talk to your parents. And I thought, no, I know my parents love me, but I also know that my parents think that this is sin. So I don't know what's going to happen. And so we talked to my parents that night for a couple of hours. My parents cried with me, is the way I remember that. They were devastated. You know, not every parent does respond well, but mine did. And they were devastated that I'd been in so much pain and hadn't felt like I could bring it forth. Started seeing a Christian psychologist, psychotherapist that I saw for 5 years weekly. And he kept me alive. Now, my real transformation began after that period, really, but I cannot emphasize enough the importance of having, which in California now, if this were my life in California, because I was 17 years old, you know, I wouldn't have been able to find, it would have been illegal for me to find this help as a minor, and I might have ended my life. And you know, so it's devastating the laws that are in place now, in some places. I mean, nobody needs help more than a minor. Minors are the ones who really need to be able to come and talk about.
Right. You know, right. And your parents, and it sounds like your parents needed some guidance as well.
They did.
You know, that they needed some coaching or some support and knowing, yes, you know, how to love you and not freak out. It sounds like they didn't freak out. From what you're saying, it sounds like they were more upset that you were in pain and they didn't know how to help you.
Big time.
You know, that was more what was on their mind. And so after this kind of 5-year period of Christian counseling, was it really just life support, or did it actively help you, or how would you characterize that?
I think, you know what, I tell people all the time, the first 2 years, I mean, it sounds ridiculous, but my first 2 years of being in therapy, I just needed someone to listen. It had been bottled up for so long, and that I just needed someone to validate, wow, Ken, that's hard. I'm so sorry that you felt that way. I don't see you that way. You know what you're about. I mean, he spent the first 2 years listening and then letting me know, Ken, he said, you are more valuable to God than just your recent behavior, like, or just what you're doing. He's like, does God have standards for our behavior? Yes, he does. Are there things that are sin and things that are not? Yes, there are. But God has grace for our sin, and he wants to help you, Ken. You don't have to be perfect for him. That's why Jesus came. Like, all things that I knew maybe intellectually, but my heart did not know them. I was trying to be perfect for God, and I'd have not met a person yet who's been able to do that, you know, and I was exhausted, and I wasn't able to receive God's love. I wasn't able to receive his help because I had this perfectionistic law that I was beating myself up with all the time. And there's so much more to God than that. So, I mean, that's a lot of what I got out of those first years of counseling, was just a deeper understanding of how God wanted to receive me and get into my mess with me, not beat me over the head with my mess.
Mm-hmm. And so after that period of counseling, that was really, it sounds like a lot of healing is going on because of how much you had been interior alone. You had been inside your own head alone. And I want to say to anybody watching here, that this is a common experience of people who have been sexually abused as children. What happened to you is not exactly sexual abuse, but the viewing of pornography could be considered abusive. Now, those other boys are not legally and morally culpable in the same way that an adult abuser is. But nonetheless, it was traumatic for you. Let's put it that way. Right. And you didn't have a way to process it. And so when you're looking at a young person who has had some kind of traumatic experience of this kind, they need an opportunity to process it. They need somebody to talk with them. They need to say it over and over until it loses its sting, you know? Yes. And so this is a really common experience, and I appreciate you sharing that. And I'm sure if people stop listening this minute, they're still going to get something that's valuable, you know, to have that affirmation. It told you, you weren't alone, among other things. Right.
That's right.
And so then what happened, Ken? Then what happened? This is really, I mean, I'm smiling because I know this has a happy ending for you. Yes. But I'm sure it was very difficult at the time.
It was, but I mean, the story does get better from here. This is not the story that you hear all the time, but in college then was when, you know, I went through most of those 5 years of counseling in college, and some of the counsel from my psychologist was, hey, you need to learn how to be one of the guys. And so I'm encouraging you to get into this Christian fraternity and get to know some guys, you know, be one of them. And that was part of my healing process. It really was. It was a very important to get to realize by experience in daily life, actually, I'm not that different from all the other guys. And actually, there's some really great guys. And, you know, all that kind of thing. So I do that. Well, in the process,
and did
of,
they know? Can
they did not.
Excuse me. Did the fellas know? They did not realize you were struggling
no
with this, but
no,
you went
I
in. You okay? Okay.
I was
because from
that
time
real...
to time.
Quiet.
Yeah. From time to time, though, I have talked to college students. I used to spend a lot of time with college students and young adults and stuff, and I would tell them, especially the guys, you need to welcome the guy. You know, if you have a friend who is dealing with same-sex attraction and he's not sure that that's who he wants, or even if he is sure that's who he wants to be,
sure.
Let him be part of the group doing guy stuff. You don't
Very
have
much.
To say, hey, it's great that you're gay. You know, you don't have to even go there. Let's just let's go canoeing or, you know, whatever, you know, whatever the guys are doing. Yeah,
absolutely. I love that. I'm so glad because that's my perspective. And I see guys experience healing that way because they've got all these beliefs internal that I'm not enough. And I'm you know, we use it as a joke, but I'm a unicorn. I don't fit. And the reality is, no, you fit way better than you think you do. You've just been banged up. You know, there's things that have happened, beliefs you've formed. And so what happened was, in my effort to learn about the grace of God, I mean, this is silliness and obviously an excuse, but I found myself that, well, I'll drink, you know, some of the guys are drinking. And so I'll drink and, you know, and then I'll experience God's grace. And I, honestly, I was so self-critical that if I had a drink, I think I experienced the relief of not beating myself up somewhat. Well, that got unhealthy. And so I would drink until I passed out. And this one night,
oh boy,
I drank, you know, got very, very drunk, passed out. And when I woke up the next morning, now I developed a stomach condition. I was in pain all the time. Long story short, 5-year illness then from that point. Tried everything medically, everything, non-traditional medicine, nothing is working. This friend of mine then from college, I'm now out of college by a few years. And this friend reconnects with me and says, how you doing? And I said, well, I've got this illness still, you know, and I was 114 pounds. I was very ill and just non-functional almost. And he called and said, how you doing? And I said, well, you know, I'm sicker than ever. He said, well, Ken, God doesn't want you to be sick. And I said, what? You know, I didn't know. My experience of God had not been one where God got active in my life and was like, you know, leading me directly. And I didn't know that really the Lord could step in and do like even like a physical healing or something like that today. I kind of just believed that all those things had passed away at some point. And when he said, well, Ken, you know, I've seen God interact with, you know, intervene in people's lives. And I've actually known people who through prayer experienced a physical healing in their body. And I was like, I need to know more about this. So we got together a few weeks later, he prayed for me and Dr. Morse, I had a knockdown drag out experience in my abdomen. I felt juices moving around in my abdomen and I my stomach growled for 30 seconds without stopping. And this whole thing, I felt the presence of chaos leave my body. And at the end of that prayer time for a few, you know, minutes, I was experiencing this, all of this pressure and pain was leaving me. And after a few hours, I had no more pain. And this is the first time in 5 years. It was unmistakable, dramatic. And now I could eat whatever I wanted. There were like 3 foods I wasn't allergic to. So I got my life back. I gained 25 pounds in a month after that. And so I realized my takeaway was, oh my gosh, God is good. I didn't know. I knew he was someone holy and that I needed to honor and serve, but I did not realize how good he was and he cared about my present condition. So my simple math in that experience was, if God's good, and if God said that homosexuality is not beneficial, it's not permittable, then he surely has some solutions to it because he's not diabolical, he's good. And I just went on a pilgrimage from that point, seeking what does following the Lord offer a person? You know, what does God want for me? What will he provide for me? And the more I started diving into that, the more I started to feel like I knew him, and that he was loving me, that he was putting people in my life that would walk with me, you know, putting me in some churches where they believed and had experienced that God would come through for people, and that God wanted to answer our prayers, that he was good. And a journey then of several years after that, I just turned around and looked backwards and realized, oh my goodness, I'm not the same person that I was. And matter of fact, that girl that I've been getting to know for this last year in my young adults group, I'm now early 30s at that point. Gosh, she's really stunning. Like, I just loved her inside and out. I loved who she was. And I gave the second glance, you know, she had long hair and she's playing with her hair and she was chatting with a friend across the room. And she had this big sparkly belt on. She dressed like a middle schooler, even though she was 27, you know, and I just thought the whole thing was very hard to understand and interesting, you know. And I just thought, gosh, she's really, I gave that a second look. I thought, gosh, she's just stunning. And I thought, whoa, I don't do that. I don't give a second look, you know. And so I, you know, I ended up asking her out a few weeks later, and we were married about a year after that. And, you know, I was so self-focused. Okay. It was all about me all the time. You know, what's my identity? What is my sexuality? You know, and it started, the Lord had rehabilitated my heart over the last few years to where I was able to be interested in giving instead of just having to self-medicate and figure out how I was. And I think in that process of him giving me a solidarity of identity in him, the focus became about him and knowing him, not about trying to change my sexuality. And when I got unself-focused and focused on knowing him, I turned around and noticed that I had different feelings. And so, you know, and just fell in love. And I have had a wonderful marriage. I mean, we're imperfect like anybody else. We work things out and, you know, we have disagreements and blah, blah, blah. But I love her, you know, like inside and out. And then we have these four amazing children that are, you know, ages 11 to 15. We have twins in there, and I'm living a much more normal life, you know, normal, than I ever imagined. And it's the most fulfilling thing because, in fact, I am a man. I'm not, there's no adjective. I got rid of all the adjectives in front of man. I'm just a man of God. I don't have to identify as anything else. And that is a place of solidarity, and it's a place of peace for me, and you know, and it wasn't before. So that's my story.
So we've actually come to about the midpoint of what is our usual show length. And I'm going to now say to Ruth Institute followers, you really must sign up for our locals channel, because we're going to take the rest of this interview over there. And I had all these questions I was going to ask you. We're not going to get to all of them. But one of the things I definitely want to talk, I want to talk to you a little bit more about the theology of what you're doing, mm-hmm. and how it impacts the ministry that you're doing. Because Ruthie's, mm-hmm. Ken and our friend Elizabeth Wanning, they have a very interesting ministry that you're going to want to hear about, because there are going to be things that they're doing that you're going to be able to use, whether you're in the ministry professions or you're a follower of Christ in some other profession, but you wish to minister to others. So let's take a break right now and head on over to Locals. It's free to sign up, and you'll be able to see the whole thing.